Hey there, people. Hey guys, my headphones are not as set up as I thought they were. We are ready for another day of streaming. Today we're doing Genesis 8. And I haven't checked my phone all day, so it is exploding. But that's okay, I'm not looking at that. I'm looking for the Twitch app so I can keep an eye on chat whilst I draw, or write, I guess, scribe. Would you look at that? For the first time, we have a stream launch announcement that is actually correct. I remembered to update it before the stream. So today, as the title does suggest accurately, we will be working on Genesis 8. We'll be beginning that one today. So I need to find my most hard pencil, which I think is a 7B or 7H. Where is my 7H pencil at? Totally unprepared for this stream. I have a 4H, but I'd rather use the 7 for this one. Did it fall on the floor? It did. Okay. Ooh! I was worried there. This is my bread and butter. Okay. So, first of all, I need to know if this is, I think this is Latin. Oh, it's a blank page. All right, cool. In that case, this is... Is that right? Yeah, it is. Okay. So this is Genesis 8. Let's get a reference here that I can draw to. This is a old copy of Genesis 7 that I had messed up the back edge of. So we will pull this out. And I'm going to use this to copy the font style and stuff. We keep that accurate. Take my tablet down there for now to get that out of the way. Comfortable here. Got a good night ahead of us. I mean, so many things between me and the paper. It's very unusual. I know I'll get used to it eventually, but it's just going to take a little bit. All right, so we use the first two lines.
Oh.
So I watched, I meant to watch the State of the Union tonight, and I forgot. partially because Matt Fred had interviewed Jimmy Akin with a 6-hour interview, and my wife and I are both fans of Jimmy Akin, so we decided to tune in and watch. And we started watching, I think, the day before yesterday. And it's just, it's a 6.5-hour interview, which is ridiculous. I don't know if you can see my lines here that I'm drawing. But all I'm doing is just kind of creating like a basic pencil sketch of what I want before I go in and do this. I do this with all the decorative lettering. That's why I do that, because that is a little bit wider than I actually wanted that to be. Now, as I recall, I was actually using a different pen size for the text up here. But then again, maybe I wasn't. I don't know. And let's see, is this it over here? I think I was using a 1. Nope, that's my super thin one. This is for detailing, which I will use this for the details of the letters, but I don't know what to do with my brush pen. Huh. I bet it's in here. Hold on. Stand by. Zero, 2. Oh, maybe it's not in here. Well, okay. As they make loud banging sounds on stream, I'm sure you all love this ASMR. Alrighty, I don't have the pen that I thought I had. I have all these art supplies in a bin right behind me, because I'm still, you know, not fully unpacked. And, oh gosh, like, I have so many art supplies in there that I could use. Oh, I found my pen! I have so many art supplies in there that I could use right now, but yeah, I have what I need for this, so that's the important thing. What I want to do here is just kind of try to keep everything kind of sharp. Like what I just did there. And there. Both times in the bottom of the E, I messed up a little bit, and the middle of the E, too. This is much more difficult than you'd think it would be. It doesn't help that my hands naturally shake some, too. I don't like that I, or that S. Okay, well, I kind of matched it, which was good. And this is my fine pen. I've been wanting to do that for a while. I don't know that I like it, but it's fine. It's always the most nerve-wracking part for me. Yeah, that doesn't look like it has a ton of confidence behind those pen strokes. Let's see if we can fix that and not make it worse. Or making it worse. Alright, that's better. I don't like the S's, but, you know. Thought I'd play around and got cute and it didn't work. Oh well, that's okay. And we need to know what the first letter of Genesis 8 is before we go any further. Because we're going to be drawing something today. Now, last time it worked out, I think that the... No, actually, I didn't. I was thinking maybe Genesis 6, the first letter was the same in both Latin and English. But Genesis 8, first letter is A. Well, that's pretty straightforward. Okay, and what is Genesis 8? We probably should read Genesis 8 before we make a decision, because I like to keep a theme going with my letters. The illuminations, as they would say. Guys, we haven't prayed yet. That's why this didn't work out right. Let's do a quick prayer. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Lord, thank you for this opportunity to share your word on Twitch, and whoever may see it, just, you know, keep them in your heart, Lord, and make sure that they find a way to get you and theirs. Lord, we have so many challenges in this world that we face. Just help us see us through them. Help us stay on the narrow path. Help us avoid temptation. Help us avoid the occasion of sin. Just sustain us with your love, Lord, as you have our entire lives. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay. So A, it's A in English. What is it in Latin? R. Okay. R in English, or R in Latin, A in English. Okay, so, Genesis 8. And God remembered Noah and all the living creatures and all the cattle which were with him in the ark, and brought a wind upon the earth, and the waters were abated. The fountains also of the deep and the floodgates of heaven were shut up, and the rain from the heaven was restrained. And the waters returned from off the earth, going and coming, and they began to be abated after 150 days. And the ark rested in the seventh month, the 7th and 20th day of the month upon the mountains of Armenia. And the waters were going and decreasing until the 10th of the month. For in the 10th month, the first day of the month, the mountains of the tops of the mountains appeared. After that, 40 days were passed. Noah, opening the window of the ark, which he had made, sent forth a raven. I don't know why I always thought it was a pigeon or a dove. He was another raven, though, which went forth and did not return till the waters were dried up upon the earth. He sent forth also, there's a dove after him, to see if the waters had now ceased upon the face of the earth. But she did not, not finding where her foot may rest, returned to him in the ark, for the waters were upon the whole earth. And he put forth his hand and caught her and brought her into the ark. And having waited yet 7 other days, he sent forth the dove out of the ark. He again sent forth the dove out of the ark. And she came to him in the evening, carrying a bow of an olive tree, with green leaves in her mouth. Noah therefore understood that the waters were ceased upon the earth. And he stayed yet another 7 days, and he sent forth a dove, which returned not to any more unto him. Therefore, in the 600th and first year, the first month, first day of the month, the waters were lessened upon the earth, and Noah, opening the covering of the ark, looked and saw the face of the earth was dried. In the second month, the 7th and 20th day of the month, the earth was dried. And God spoke to Noah, saying, Go out of the ark, thou and thy wife, thy sons and the wives of thy sons with thee, all living things that are with thee of all flesh, as well as in the fowls as in beast, and all creeping things that creep upon the earth. And they love that phrase. Bring out with thee, and go ye upon the earth, increase and multiply upon it. So Noah went out, he and his sons, his wife, and the wives of his sons with him. And all things and cattle and creeping things that creep upon the earth, according to their kinds, went out of the ark. And Noah built an altar unto the Lord, and taking of all cattle and fowls that were clean, offered holocausts upon the altar. And the Lord smelled a sweet savor and said, I will no more curse the earth for the sake of man, for the imagination of and thought of man's heart are prone to evil thoughts from his youth. Therefore, I will no more destroy every living soul as I have done. And all the days of the earth, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, night and day shall not cease. Okay. So, I'm thinking the olive branch should be our theme for the letter here. Thinking of that olive branch. Either the olive branch. I like the olive branch. They actually mention a plant in this verse. So I think we need to look up olive, what olive branches look like. So let's take a look here. Didn't mean to do that. Okay. So first of all, what do olive branches look like? Okay, here we go. And there's our picture of the dove with the olive branch. You really can't see what I'm looking at here. Let me scoot this over. That's better. Okay. There's a little bit of a glare there. I'll move this back a bit. Okay, that's better. You can kind of see it here. What we're looking at. I still have the glare, but you don't, from what I can tell. So that's good. Okay. So they have very long leaves. They are not, well, are they staggered or are they not staggered? Because these are not staggered. These are staggered. It looks like the actual picture of the olive branch. The leaves are not staggered. They are symmetrical. Let's see if that's true here too. Yeah, it looks like they're symmetrical leaves. So that is good. Okay, let's do a are you plugged into Google here? Let me pull this out of the way. Let's see if we can find an example of olive branch lettering. So this is what's coming up for that. Not quite the vibe I'm going for. Yeah, these are definitely meant to be symmetrical, though. Golly, guys. I have to yawn, I'm sorry. Oh, here we go. This is something. So in this case, the A, this is more like an olive, this is more just like, these aren't really olive, but it's not a bad idea for lettering, though. So that's an option. I like this, too. We have, like, a wooden type A. You have the glare, I think, again, but you have, like, a wood A or a wood R. That's interesting, and then you can have, like, an olive branch coming off of that. That's another example of it, but that's way too detailed for my purposes. I think I like the idea of doing that A tree. Then maybe with a dove, like flying away from it or pulling something off of it on the left side of it, maybe. Oh, that might be kind of cool. That might be really cool. I can do that yeah, okay. That's what we're doing. Okay, let's go back. And we're going to take that. We're going to take that A from the tree that we liked. That's not the tree that we liked. That's some Chinese bull crap version of the tree that we liked. Here we go. That's what we liked. Okay, we got to make that into an olive tree. And so I think for this one, we may not get a box. Let's see. I don't know. Let's go ahead and... Where's my level? Oh, here's my level. Okay, do we have a level desk right now or no? No, it is off to this left... A little bit high on the right side. Okay, we can work with that. That is A-okay. What's interesting is that the paper actually is level. Didn't expect to see that happen. Excuse me. Thank you. Move it off to the side a little bit more. Okay. And then to get the perpendicular line. And then we need to get the diagonal line. This is just to make sure everything stays square. And around. Keep everything square. And connect the mess we just made. All right, that's our box. Okay. So we have a kind of like a two-tone thing going on here. So we have root thing going on here for the A, kind of bumpy, and what olive tree roots actually look like, and I cannot be bothered to look that up with this, so. And really, this is actually two trees kind of leaning together is what the idea of this is, so. Probably should try to extend this a bit more, aim it down a little bit. And I'm not trying to match exactly, I want it to be my own too, but I'm just kind of using it for inspiration because I like generally how it looks. You know, I messed up a little bit here. This needs to come down a little bit more like that. And then our second one. I'm just going to sketch that in here. A little bit too thick right in here, so we gotta thicken up the base of that trunk a little bit. Okay, and here we have our second tree almost behind the first one, which is darker than the others. And on here, I'll have this one going back to quite a bit, but on this tree back here is where we will have our olive branch. We'll have it start kind of low. How thick that is. It needs to be a little bit thinner than that. I mean, by the time I actually like draw the lines and stuff, it will be pretty thin. Okay. Now we need to draw the dove. I think with the, let's do that. The thing is, we're reading really close to the margins in here. Maybe what we'll do is for the border, we'll have the dove. And I think we'll be content with the olive branch only on this tree. Let's find a good olive branch example again from the very beginning. Olive branch. There we go. Okay. Getting really close to that center. I don't think you'll be able to see the detail on that very well, which is unfortunate. I almost wish I had moved the letter over more than I normally have it, but there's not too much we can do about it. It'll be okay. Yeah, talking to the stream. My wife woke up. Concerned that I was talking to somebody. And I was. I think.
Ego sumo
Oh, guys, I just... Oh, my goodness. Such a big mistake. Mm-hmm. That is a doozy. That is a doozy of an error. Alright, so... I think I have an idea for fixing this. Thank you. Yeah, the A in Genesis 7 is supposed to be, I don't know if you can see it that well, but it's supposed to be like a, you're supposed to see like mountains underwater inside the A. Thank you, though. This is actually the wrong, the one I did is a little bit different. I actually messed up this sheet after I did the first page, so I had to like go back and do it again, and so this is actually a mess up, but the one I did is very similar to this one. I tried using this as like the basis for that one. I think the only thing I didn't do is I didn't have the lines behind the A to darken this up. I think I'm just going to color that in a little bit darker on the real version that I have. And now we have a really hard decision here, because in the past, I have done a box kind of behind the letter, and I want to keep up with that theme. However, I've always done like a wood kind of colored box-ish. Maybe a gold, nah, yeah. I have to think of a color that's going to work good for that before I commit to doing it. I'm thinking we might do like a light blue, like a sky blue type thing. Yeah, I think we're going to do like clouds and stuff in the background. Yeah, we're going to do clouds in the background. Okay. Okay, that's all we're going to do for that. I will go ahead and erase the lines now before I forget. So, interesting tip. I'll show you here in a second. When you're erasing, if you erase in the direction of the line itself, you actually get in there quite a bit better and can erase things easier with less effort. But I have another cool, that wasn't the cool tip I wanted to show you. There's another cool tip I got. Let me do my thing really quick here. I get kind of aggressive with this. And to prove my point, I'm going to go ahead and get rid of these lines up here, too. Really, I'm trying not to rotate the paper while I'm doing this for the sake of YouTube. When I combine all this into, like, one big old video, I don't want the paper, like, moving all over the place. I hate it when I do that. So I'm trying to keep things as still as possible while I do this. Okay, so I've erased my stuff. This is the trick I wanted to show you. So you can kind of see on the eraser, there is like some dirt and stuff on there now that I've done all this erasing work. And this isn't bad, but sometimes it gets... Do I have a bad eraser by chance? Maybe I don't. Okay. Anyways, sometimes it gets really bad. And you know, like if it gets really bad and you try erasing, you're really just going to be smudging the graphite or ink or whatever is on here on the paper, and you're kind of ruining the paper when you do that, like the whiteness of the paper, I guess. So what you can do is, if you're wearing jeans or I have like a thermal kind of material, cotton material on my legs right now, all you have to do is like rub this on your leg. It just takes a few little wipes and it goes away and it's all cleaned up again. So that's a cool little trick that I've learned, and I like it. Sometimes with a pencil with a hard eraser. Yeah. So just like erase your jeans and it goes away. It cleans up really easily when you do that. Okay. Do I want the color? I kind of do. Yeah, I want a color. I haven't colored anything in a while. I didn't color Genesis 7 because I had already done it before. I want to color this one. And I have an idea now in my head of what I want. I can copy that on... I can copy that on Genesis 8 in Latin. Okay, so we got to pick our colors. These are Bic alcohol mark... they say they're permanent markers. These are really... they're very fine-tip pens. And what I... They didn't even say ultra fine point on there. But what really impressed me with these, I didn't notice when I picked these up. These are actually, I'm like 95% sure, alcohol pens. So coming from Bic, which is a very, you know, good company in pens, I wasn't expecting that. Alcohol inks are just more expensive, but these things blend so nicely in like little fine areas. Finer areas than I have Copic markers that I could have used too. But oh my goodness, these blend so well together. Okay, so we're going to go with brown. This is probably more like an orange. Some of these I remember are misleading a little bit in their color. So I think... Okay, I hate doing this, but we're going to do a little test on Genesis 7. So this is our darker color. This is again this is not the actual Genesis 7 that I am doing this on. This is the messed up sheet. Okay, this is our lighter color. Alright, I like those two together. And this is our more orange hued color. And that is definitely orange. We don't want that one. And let's see, this might not be as orange. I think this is actually the color I'm going to want. I think, you know, it looks very yellow. But I'm looking for it is very yellow. I'm looking for a very like tan color for highlighting. I kind of like that one. Yeah, I think I like these two together. No, maybe I don't. Maybe I like this one better than the other one, though. Okay, so you're being retired. I like the vibrancy of the other color instead. And I think then we'll be shading. Let's see. This is probably going to be very pink. Yeah, it is. And we rejected that one already. Here's our... Did I try this one yet? I don't remember. I just lost it. Give me 1 second here. Okay. Oh, this is like... That's like very like similar to these down here. But it's... I don't like the vibrancy of the lack of vibrancy in the color of that. Put that back up here. Okay, so I think what we're going to do is we're going to do a... we need to pick a color for highlighting, and I don't really have one that I'm in love with. This is going to be too green. Or very yellow. Not the color I thought that was going to be. But maybe this will work for highlighting. And then for our shadows, I am feeling, let's see, we have mountains, we have a blue background, white clouds. We don't want a blue, we want something blue. Maybe this purple would be good for a shadow color. Come on, shadow color. Let's see what we got. Yeah, it's not too bad. It looks something a little bit more, that's not too bad. Yeah, I can smell the alcohol. Need something lighter for the shadow color, perhaps. I like that. Maybe this one. Maybe this one. Okay, we're going to do this one for the shadow color. And we need something for the sky. And we're going to do two different blues for the sky. And these are the two lightest blues I think I have. So let's see what these two look like together. Well, that's very dark. Almost too dark. And our lighter color. Yeah, okay, so we're only doing that lighter color. This blue is way too dark for what I want. We have this lighter green color here. Let's see what this does. Yeah, it's more of like an aqua color. And we have a grayish blue color here. Let's see what this one is. I think this is going to be too dark, though. But let's see. Oh, yeah, very dark again. The darkest blue I had. Well, not the darkest. That's over here. But, okay. Can I make this? Oh, wait, yeah, it's a little bit too green. Okay. Are we good? I think we're good. Okay. Let's go ahead and put this out of the way for now. Okay. So it's like the paints where it's acrylics or water painting or oil. Like a tree, right? Yeah, so the A is a tree, like an olive tree-ish. Really, I was going to draw a dove flying over here too, but I don't think I'm going to have the space for it. So we're going to kind of fit the dove in and the details kind of around when we do the illumination of the pages themselves. So anyways, we are... Yeah, we are going to fit the dove in here somehow in the illumination. It's just... I kind of fit snails in over here because I was like, oh, that's kind of cutesy, you know? And I thought it'd be nice to have a dove over here too, but... I think the amount of detail I need for a dove isn't really appropriate for the size of the A that I have here. So the snails are very simple. The dove would just be a generic bird. Okay, so we need... We'll go with the... We should do the highlights first. And, oh, you know what? Yeah, we'll do the highlights first. I was kind of having second thoughts about that a little bit, but... I just want the slightest little highlights on this tree. Just give it a little bit of like a tiniest little bit of a glow. And we're going to go ahead and... The thing with alcohol markers is you have a limited work time with these. So you got to work kind of fast. And so what I do is I put the highlight in to kind of mark the area where I want it. And that'll be fine. And then... I surround that with the color of... the actual object itself, and I'll have to fill all of this in. I always try to make sure that like I put on a little bit too much ink just to make sure that everything kind of bleeds together really nicely. And if I leave a little white space, that's okay. That's not the end of the world. So we're going to come back in with the light marker here and blend everything together all nice and pretty black. So I got these for like, you know, $20, I think, only. I think they're on sale. I got them for like a really good deal, though. And I got them just for like writing post-it notes, you know, like... Oh, it'd be nice to have colors for, like, making little notes for myself and stuff. And I took them out, and I was like, oh, my gosh, you smell like alcohol. And I was like, do these blend? And I tried blending. I was like, oh my gosh, he's blending like alcohol markers. I think these are alcohol markers. I was so thrilled. And like, they didn't market these as that, but like, if they had, they could have charged like twice as much for it and people would have ate them up. So, all right, so that's our, that's that. Let's get the shadow on now. We said we were going to deal with that purple for the shadow. Yeah, that's nice. Yeah, I got a really good deal on these. And sometimes I look for deals for paints. Yeah, like, when you have a, when you have like a type of paint that you like, and you see it's on sale, like, I'm always skeptical, you know, but like, I haven't had to buy paints in a while. I don't paint a ton. And when I do, I rarely ever finish what I'm painting just because I get frustrated with it. But, yeah, but when you find an art supply that you like, it's your medium. And for me, like, alcohol markers are my physical medium that I just, I love working with them. When you find something that's like really great like that, you just like, you buy all you can, you know? It's been good lately because I haven't been drawing as much. Which is not actually good, but like, it's worked out well. But there's this equation that kind of goes through your head of like, okay, how many of these can I buy before my wife gets upset? And while I'm not drawing, I'm not really looking for, to replace things so as much. So I'm not in, I'm not really hunting for deals like I had been before. But yeah, I do have to worry about that quite a bit because I can get a little bit crazy with my art purchases, and especially for how little I've been drawing lately, I cannot justify, oh, I forgot the green for the leaves. That's okay. But yeah, I can't justify the expenses anymore. So, we need the lighter color first for the highlights because we want to do this the same way for consistency's sake. One of the great things about alcohol markers, though, is that it's kind of like acrylic paint, sort of. Like, it can be very forgiving if you have patience and enough ink. What I love about acrylic is that like it dries relatively quick. So if you make a mistake, you can wait for it to dry. You know, usually the same day or if not next day. And then, you know, you just, like, paint right over it, and nobody will be the wiser. That's what I love about acrylic paint. Alcohol markers, they dry much quicker, which is convenient. However, they don't cover as well. And especially the bigger issue is that light colors, dark colors will cover a light color very easily. But light colors covering other light colors and light colors coloring dark colors and dark colors coloring dark colors, they don't cover quite as easily. But if you have patience and you just sit there and you keep on putting layer after layer on, it will change to a lighter color. I've had to do that on a couple of occasions. I don't like doing it, though, because alcohol ink is outrageously expensive. And I have a way of like justifying some art purchases, but alcohol ink is so expensive that I cannot justify that. I'd almost rather start over from scratch than have to do that. Okay. Let's get our purple shadow color going here. Now, years ago, I did get a set of oil-based paints. I just wanted to experiment because I heard like a lot of really great things about them. But in all the great things I heard about oil-based paints, one of the things that nobody ever bothered to tell me was just how long it takes for that stuff to dry. Oh my goodness. Like, you paint entirely differently between acrylics and oils. Like, you can't just like put paint on there and expect it to be dry, you know, 15 minutes later. Yeah, unless you put on like a super, super light coat. And when you watch like Bob Ross doing his thing, like, you know, the exception of the very things in the very most foreground, it's usually like very thin coats of things that he puts on there. The thickness of oil is nice too. It's just, it takes so long. Like, if you put a thick coat of oil on, it seems like it takes like a month for the stuff to dry, and I'm not exaggerating. Like, it takes a long time. And so if you want to work with it or paint, you know, work over it or something, like, you can't. You have to wait for the thing to dry through. That drives me nuts. I don't know if there's a trick to making it dry faster. There has to be something to spray on it, I hope. But oh my goodness, that just... I should have watched Bob Ross more closely to kind of get an idea of what he was doing. I don't want to use that dark color for that. Maybe we'll use this dark color for like a little hiding place in here. And then we'll use the lighter color to blend that out. Okay, I like that. That's good. And maybe we'll put some purple over that just to kind of make it a lighter... There we go. So you can see that's more... Okay, let's get these leaves done. I'm going to pull out some more colors for greens. Oh, it's a neon green. I need like a... Could be this one. Okay, I'm thinking probably this guy and this guy look pretty natural to me. So let's use these. Or do I want natural or do I want like... I think I want natural for the leaves. That's one green. Oh, that's way too dark. Way too dark. I don't have enough space for a shadow color in here. This is my way too dark one. That's even darker. But it's more natural, though. Okay, so we're going to use this one. For the darkest of the dark. Oh, goodness. Okay, we got to put some stuff away. Hold on a second. Oh, we're good right now. Okay. We need a lighter green. Probably this guy. It's going to be our best bet. Because the other one, I think, will be too light. I don't love that color, though. Let's try this one. It's not coming off. There we go. Okay, that these are our colors. Okay, perfect. The color looks nothing like this mint color on here. That's fine. Okay, let's go here. Put our ruler away. Hey. Yeah, I want to blend this just a little bit. The contrast here is a little bit too much. Okay, that works. Yeah, it's pretty muted. I like that. Let's use that blue now. Okay, now I can still see that outline, or the line that I had up there, and that's going to be very noticeable with a light color like this. So we're gonna erase this a little bit better. The thing I like about markers too is that you can't damage it by using an eraser over it. Okay, that's better. Yeah, so the tree is actually meant to be an olive tree. So I'm very glad that's what it reminds you of. That is actually a huge compliment and a very much a relief. That's exactly the tree I was going for. Man, that is a lot darker than I was hoping it was going to be. Although, you know what? I might have a thing for that. Let's see if my markers are actually in the bin that's labeled art supplies. I don't know that they are or not. Oh, come on. Come on, Copics. Oh, this does not look well. Thank you. Well, they're not down here. I am not going to run downstairs to the basement to do a wild goose chase for these things, so... Yeah. But a bit sad, part of remembering that this is when Jesus was sweating blood. Oh my gosh, yeah. You know, like, The Passion of the Christ is such a good movie, but it's such a difficult movie to watch, too. I love the movie. I love the movie so much, but like, it makes you realize the weight of your sins. Like every frame of that movie could be paused, and like it would be a like this like beautiful like Michelangelo like or not Michelangelo like a Raphael like fresco or something, you know, like it is really 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 beautifully done. Really beautifully done, but yeah, but like it challenges you in ch such a hard way, because like you're just constantly reminded through all the suffering in the movie, like this is for me, this is for me. Like he's doing this, he's humbled himself to this point because he loves me, you know, like oh my gosh. Every year I tell myself, gosh, I need to make it a point to watch this movie every single Good Friday, you know? And without fail, I always like find something else to do, and I'm not proud of that. But this year will be different. I saw it when it first came out in theaters, which you're gonna again say you were barely alive, I'm sure. That's back in 2004, 2005, I think that came out. It came out in 2004 because I remember getting the DVD and I was still in the Air Force in California, so that would have been 2005 the DVD came out. So I think the movie came out in 2004. And phenomenal. Like I was like, I love this movie. I love that they didn't speak English. I love everything about this movie. You know, like last night, okay, not last night, Tuesday night, I was at this it's like a it's like a class for teaching basic Christianity stuff. I thought it was gonna be more advanced than what it is. I'll leave it at that. But anyways, like we were like every week we have like a different icebreaker question to kind of get the group started and talking. It's a group thing, you know? And every week they ask a different question to kind of get the group talking a little bit, and they ask, what's your favorite movie? And I hate being asked my favorite, because like I have so many different movies that I like a lot. Like, I have my favorite, like, what's your favorite, like, my favorite movie, like, okay, my favorite movie as far as, like, to, like, watch again and again and again, is not The Passion of the Christ. I've seen it, I think, three times in total, as much as I love the movie, and I own it, too. But I just, like, it's a really hard watch, you know? So, like, does that make it not my favorite movie because I don't watch it all the time? If it's my favorite movie that I watch all the time, probably the Speed Racer movie from 2008. If it's my, favorite like know, what movie like made me like feel like laugh the hardest or whatever. Like that's gonna be a different movie. Like what movie was like, what's my favorite movie for like being groundbreaking, you know? Or it's just so many different things it could be, you know? So like, I don't like that question, but yeah, like I was thinking all the movies I was thinking of, I didn't think of The Passion of the Christ, but I really should have. It would have been kind of like lame probably to say that in that group, but and somebody else might have already said it too, I don't remember. But yeah, I was not I should have said that one. I probably should have. Because really good art. I'm reminded of Andy Kaufman, who is a guy who's like a very controversial comedian. But he said, like, my job isn't just to make you laugh. My job is to make you feel. And he did that, all right. He made people angry, and he did a lot of things to make people feel different emotions all the time. But that's also why he's one of my favorite artists of any medium, whatever, because although I think he did do like physical art mediums too, but he was primarily an actor. Like he's my favorite artist of all time because he really went all in on that, like, I'm going to make people feel with my art, and they're going to laugh, they're going to cry, they're going to get viciously angry and threaten to kill you, kill me. And it's just like, that is dedication to craft, and I love that. All right, A is done. Let's, that only took 1 hour and 17 minutes. Oh, man. Okay, so much for getting too much done with Genesis 8 tonight. We will get started with it. You know, okay, this is how good The Passion of the Christ was. I saw it in theaters, and for the life of me, I don't remember if it had subtitles or not. Like, that's how beautiful the movie was. I remember when I got it, they had the option to watch it with subtitles or watch it without subtitles. You had to make a decision before you watched the movie. And this is my second time watching the movie on DVD. And I decided to watch it without subtitles, and it was exactly as I remembered it. So I don't know if I've seen it with subtitles or not. And I, to be honest with you, I don't know that you need subtitles to watch that movie. I really don't think you do. And I'm kind of a snob when it comes to that sort of thing. Like, I like things in its original language and stuff, with the exception of anime. I prefer subtitle or dubs of my anime, but like, yeah, like for some reason that movie in particular, like, it, like, you understood everything that was being said, in part because you've heard it a million times at church, you know, or as many times as years you've been alive in church, you've heard it. But yeah, like, just the story itself is already like kind of embedded in us. Like, we know it well enough that when we see it in another language, while it's being acted and shot that well, you know exactly what's going on. It was just like, I don't know if that movie like is supposed to have subtitles or not, but I don't think it needs them. I really don't. Even learning the Japanese language, nice. I, however, have not. I have tried, and I understand how bad American dubs are of anime. I really understand how bad the dubs are. I really do, and I wish that wasn't the case. However, when I'm watching TV like that, here's the thing, all right? I'm an artist, okay? I want to appreciate the artwork. If I'm reading subtitles, which I agree is more accurate and more entertaining, you know, story-wise, to read the subtitles, But, like, if I'm reading subtitles, I'm not looking at the art. I want to look at the art. And that's why I prefer dubs of my stuff, and I can't be bothered to learn Japanese. Before I get too far along here, I'm going to put these pens back where they belong. And by back where they belong, I mean back in the case. I'm not putting them back in the same order that they were in. Duolingo. Duolingo is awesome. I started using that to learn Italian. My wife and I, when we first started dating, we were talking about when we got married. Like, we talked about marriage right away, but like we were talking about like doing a honeymoon in Italy. That was back before she decided not to trust me to go overseas anywhere. So. I had to tell her there are certain countries that I'm not allowed to go to, and she should not go to either because of my background. And they got her worried about the countries that we could and could not go to. And yeah, Italy is perfectly safe. But anyways, yeah, we started learning Italian and Duolingo for, we'd spent about 4 weeks doing it. And, you know, it was good. If you keep it up, and that's the thing, you have to keep it up. Otherwise, you lose it. Especially when you're just beginning, too. What's the movie called Taken? I have never seen Taken. But I am not showing her that movie. Thankfully, that's not really her thing. She's more of like a rom-com type girl. So I'm not worried about her wanting to see that movie either. Okay. I just hit the microphone there. That's what that big sound was. Oh, no. Hang on, I just closed out of my English Bible, which was a mistake. Douay, Rheims Bible. There we go. And I think I'm using, Bible study tools. Go into... Yeah, I gotta find a better version of this to use. I don't like... I don't trust... I like this version of the online Bible because it breaks everything down one line at a time. There's a glare there, I apologize. But, no, the glare's not that bad. There's like, it's every verse has its own line. And it makes it much easier for me to write to that. However, I don't really trust this tool. I haven't found any problems with it yet. But there's just little things as far as like grammar goes and things that I'm kind of like, is that right? And when I do look, it's correct. But I don't know. I just don't trust these. I don't really trust this version. This is just kind of like this particular thing has all different versions of the Bible in it. I don't like that it breaks they call them deuterocanonical books, but like they split the Old Testament up in like they don't consider the Catholic books and the Orthodox books of the New Testament to be of the Old Testament to be part of the Old Testament, which is not fair and not right. So. Anyways, yeah, I'm going to try to find a different tool for this, but in the meantime, this is working well enough, so I will find something that I like better in the future. Okay, we're going to move this over here a bit, because we can. And there's that glare again. Let's move that over to the side for you a bit more. Okay, let's begin writing. Thank you. Maybe we should learn Hebrew. If I decided to learn a language like Hebrew, I would want to learn ancient Hebrew. I feel like that is more relevant to me than Hebrew would be. I mean, I'm sure it's not the case, but like every single Jewish person I've met speaks English, and every Israeli citizen that I have met speaks English. And everybody speaks English already. So, like, why would I want to learn that language? You know, it's, ancient Hebrew is more of interest to me, but yeah, I just can't be bothered. Like, I started learning German in high school. I took German again in college. I know some German. I feel like if I went to Germany, I would be okay. I wouldn't thrive, but I feel like I'd be okay. And if there's another language I was going to learn, it would be Spanish, just because, like, that is actually relevant. But, at least in my life here in America. But, yeah, like, any other language, it just feels like it's kind of like a wasted effort for me. Seen a lot of Jewish people speaking English or Spanish. I've not seen Spanish before, but I've not seen Spanish before. That's interesting. You know, that makes some sense. It does make some sense. Actually, the more I think about it, it makes a lot of sense, actually. Did we lose sound there for a minute, or did you just go mute, or did you accidentally mute the speakers? I do appreciate you looking after the stream, though. We didn't hear music for a second. Yeah, sometimes between songs, it stops, and I've also had it occasionally happen, where it just kind of glitches out for a second. I'm not sure what that's about. It probably has something to do with me not restarting my computer in 3 months. Could have something to do with that, too. Yeah, I don't know if you guys hear the audio cutting in and out like that. I'm very sorry about that. I'm not sure what's going on there. I will try restarting my computer tonight, and hopefully that goes away. So I think we're going to go to verse 12 here. That'll give us 13 through 22, another 10 verses to have on the next page. And then we'll be done with Genesis 8 on the next page. We have a weird situation here where the translation says, "And he stayed yet other 7 days, and he sent forth a dove, and which returned not any more unto him." I don't know if that should be yet other 7 days or yet another 7 days. I want to find that out because I don't want to mess this up with the last verse of this page. Let's see. Do a search for Genesis chapter 8. Yet other 7 days. Yeah. Gosh, it bothers me so bad. Yet other 7 days. It is. Okay. Yeah, it's like, I think it could be human error, but then, like, it's in two different... What's a different translation of the Bible say? Let's see. This is Douay, Rheims, 1899 edition. Let's see. I'm trying to find a... Let's see, maybe the let's see what the New Catholic Bible says. Okay, this is another 7 days. Let's try. Because the Douay Rheims is. Let's see what the King James says. I don't use this often, but. This is another 7 days here, too. Okay, you know what? I have a copy of the Douay Rheims in my basement. No, wait, it's in my garage. Hang on. Just hang in there for just a minute. I'm going to go dig this out because I don't want to mess this up because I'm going to look like such an idiot if somebody reads this and I'm just like, ooh, I found it on the internet and that's not going to be good. I'll be right back, guys. Hang in there, please. Okay, I'm back. Oh, of course, it was the first book I packed away, so it was at the very bottom of the bin. Okay, Genesis chapter 8. 7, 8, and what is this, verse 12? Yeah. He stayed yet other 7 days. Okay. That's the version. It is written, that's right. You're a black man, Israelite, God hates white people. Well, I don't think God hates people. That's a very interesting comment to have. Kind of a sad ideology, to be honest with you. That anybody should be hated for the color of their skin is just sad, you know? So, God is good, 2, 3, 1, 6. I agree, God is good. I disagree that race has any measure at all in God's love for us. Race is a human construct. It has the visions we place on ourselves because of race are completely man-made. Does that mean that God hates Italians less than, like, Irish people or something, too? Like, does the darkness of your skin correspond with how much a person is hated? It's ridiculous. It is absolutely ridiculous, so. Brian, you're exactly right. We are all the same color, just in slightly different shades, you know? Like, it's... Ah, that's just stupid. Okay. Anyways, it is written, however, that the Douay Rheims version does say other instead of another, which is odd. But that is written. I should have read the first comment before that, first before I affirmed it is written. Okay, what do we got? Douay Rheims. Okay. Can I report him? Banned user. There we go. Reason. Racism. There we go. Ban. Okay, he's banned from the channel. I just don't have the patience for racists. I don't. Maybe he was trolling. I don't know. But you know what? Like, if he's gonna be trolling like that, don't be trolling over race. I just don't have the patience for it. And don't be trolling, especially don't be trolling over, like, God's love for one race over another. Like, that's just stupid. He probably was trolling. I will say, however, there is a group of people, they are, black Jewish people, they consider themselves the true Israelis, the true line of Judaism. And it is insanely racist. I was shocked because I saw them on public television. Like, they had rented time out on the local, like, PBS station to, like, spread their propaganda. And I'm, like, watching this, like, what in the world is PBS thinking? Like, if a bunch of white supremacists did that, there's no way they'd go for that. Like, why is it any different, you know? Well, that's just, okay, so that's just the thing, okay, so, like, not even necessarily the lost tribes, but, like, just the Roman diaspora, like, after, what was it, year 72, the temple was destroyed, and Rome kicked all the Jews out of Israel, shouldn't say all, the vast majority of the Jews out of Israel, After that happened, like, they just, like, you know, they had no choice. They just went to the four corners of the earth, figuratively speaking. I know the world's not flat. Anyways, they went to the, you know, the four different corners of the earth that's spread out all over the place. And it's like, there were people who undoubtedly went to Africa, because, again, like, going to Africa and going to Europe was, like, just a, they're equal options, kind of, you know. Africa might have been a more civilized place for a lot of these people to go. So they go to Africa. They're going to, of course, intermarry, because people don't care about race, whether they intermarried in Europe or they intermarried in Africa or in Asia, for that matter, too. They're going to intermarry. The quote-unquote race, the skin color, is going to change over time to reflect that. And so it's, like, it's not a surprise that there are black Jewish people. It's just baffling that race is such an important part of their identity. And that's if they are even, you know, truly descendants of the original diaspora. This could just be like a, I haven't done that much research into it, but it could very well just be like a little cult that kind of popped up, and it's like, hey, you know, like, we were all, you know, like, how do I put this? We were originally African people. I guess what I'm saying is that these would be people who were originally African of some country or another, ended up in the slave market, brought to the United States, or brought to, you know, someplace out here as slaves, found their freedom, became, you know, American citizens after the emancipation, you know, slowly got their rights or whatever. And then during the 1950s, 60s, 70s, probably 60s, this idea kind of popped up, like, no, wait, like, you know, the Bible's all about us. We're the God's chosen people, and the white people are the enemy, you know? And it's a reaction to white racism, absolutely. But, yeah, it doesn't matter if it's white on black or black on white, racism. It's just stupid, so. Okay. I think racism is still around, okay? But it's like not nearly as common as I think people think it is. So like, yes, there are white supremacists. There are people like that guy who was just here that are still blatantly racist. God hates black people. God hates white people. Whatever. One race is superior to another. Whatever. Does not matter. It doesn't matter. Like those people are still around. I think part of that is just that it's so easy to like look at somebody and being like, you know, hey, he doesn't look like me. He's not one of us, you know? I think that we in this country now are very tribal minded. Like, our tribes are pretty much our politics a lot of times. So if you're conservative, you rally behind your conservative people. If you're progressive, you want to rally behind progressives, and those are your tribes. And so I think that is like the underlying identity of every American to some way or another. And with just how bitter politics are right now and how tribal everything is right now, it's always us versus them. And there's never anything really cooperative in our relations with others that we don't identify with. And that is very unfortunate for a great multitude of reasons. But I think what most people think of as like widespread racism is not actually racism. I think it's more of like a I almost want to say like ethnic superiority. And what I mean by ethnic is like not the color of your skin, but like the community that you belong to and the culture that you belong to. And I think those are the things now that are dividing us. I have to be very careful with what I say here, but because we're talking about a very sensitive subject, okay? If you look at the white community and the black community, look at white people in general and black people in general, okay? There are certain stereotypes, I think, that are, for the most part, accurate-ish, okay? Generally speaking, white people down south like their country music, okay? Are there white people down south that don't like country music? Yes, okay, there are. But, you know, they have their country music down there. White people in Boston listen to something else. You know, you'll be hard-pressed to go into a restaurant in Boston and they're playing country music. It's spreading up here in Chicago a little bit, but it's not as widespread as it is down south. Up here, you know, like my in-laws, they don't listen to country music. They listen to like, you know, classic rock, you know. In a similar way, okay, as you know, people up here are listening to classic rock. White people down there are listening to country music. There's this other stereotype of, you know, the general population for black Americans is it's stereotype rap music, you know? And again, like, not everybody listens to it. Some, many don't, but many more do. It's just one thing, but like you also look at how people dress. People dress differently between the white community and black community, generally speaking. Some white people dress with their pants hanging around their knees. And I know a lot of, you know, I've met a lot of black people in my line of work that wear suits to work every day because they work for government. You know, these are very general stereotypes, what we're talking about, you know, what I think would fairly be, maybe unfairly be called black culture, white culture, whatever, okay? And I think there's a tendency for people to have a superior view of, especially white people, have this idea that, how we dress is superior to how you dress. Well, the music we listen to is superior to the stuff you listen to. And it probably cuts both ways. I don't know. But, there are these differences that happen because... there are these differences, I think, that are there. And just the integration... that's the word I'm looking for. Yeah, here's a good example, okay? When Irish immigrants came to this country, they were considered, on the same level as Native Americans and Black people, who are just the recently freed slaves. There were a lot of Irish immigrants who came here, and their only chance of being married was to marry another Irish person or to marry a Black person. And they married Black people, and it was fine. No big deal. You know, it's just the social ladder where they were in the social ranking of things. The people had signs up in their windows, Irish need not apply. That's here in the United States, you know. And after World War I, and especially after World War II, and the same thing happened with the Italians, too, actually. They came here and they were treated as second-class citizens. But after World War I and World War II, in those wars, especially World War II, because they made an effort to just throw people together, and they didn't. It wasn't all in World War I. They had entire communities of men together fighting in the same unit, and when that unit got wiped out, an entire community lost all their men. And so in World War II, they made a better effort to not let entire communities of men all serve together. And as a result of that, they didn't have time to figure out, he's Italian. Let's put him with an Italian regiment. They were just we're going to put all the white people together. It's just easier. We're in a little bit of a rush here because we're kind of late to this World War II game. So you had all these, white Anglo-Saxon Protestants serving alongside, Catholic, Irish Catholic and Italian Catholic, soldiers. And they got out of the war, and they had their problems when they first met them and had to serve with them. But you fight together and you live together, in a foxhole, and you're kind of you become brothers. It doesn't matter what differences you have. You all bleed, red, white, and blue, And so after the war was over, these guys came home and they're like, hey, mom and dad, you can't say that about Irish people. I have Irish friends. I have Italian friends. I served with them. They saved my life. I would be dead if not for them. And you have enough people coming back like that, and the racism is largely over because you see your brother in arms in every Irish person, Italian person that you see. And all of a sudden, with the number of jobs that were available in the post-war American economy, there's a lot of upward mobility. And so it really changed the fortunes of the Irish and Italian immigrants. Unfortunately, the army was still segregated at that time between white and Black people. And so the black soldiers did not get to benefit from that as veterans. So when they came out of the service, some people knew what they did. The Tuskegee Airmen was a great example of that. But generally speaking, they didn't serve together in the same way. And so it was still possible to maintain that racism towards Black people that had been there since the beginning. And it really was a missed opportunity, I think. And then it just never really stopped because it kind of got embedded, I think, a little bit too much in American society after that. But I don't think that many people today are truly truly racist. I just think that they see the amount of crime in the black neighborhoods and the amount and just different things about, you know, and it's not even going to say it's you know, this is the fault of black people that their communities are like this. It's not. Like, it's the, you know, it is the result of a racist history that people are still living like this. And I think it's just hard to break out of that because of the conditions of the schools there and everything else. And I think there's some political stuff happening there too, where it's silly to expect that by electing the same, I don't want to get too political here because this is a Bible stream, but like, you elect the same political party in every single election in inner cities. Every single election you elect the same political party and your problems keep on getting worse and you keep on voting for that party. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy in a way there too. Like, I'm not saying that's the only problem. It's not. There are other problems, but that is a huge one, and nobody's willing to address it, it seems like, which is just such a shame. Is it because they took Christianity out of schools? Well, here's the thing, all right? So, like, I don't think so. I think I think, because like, if you think about it, way back in the day when, like, back when America, like Southern Americans at least, still had slaves, like, they saw justification for slavery in the Bible. It's very different than what was happening in America, but they saw justification for it. Depending on the area that you're in, people can and have abused the Bible and biblical history and just, you know, biblical scholarism they've just abused it in very, very bad ways. And I don't know, like, on a very high tier level, I don't think it's a result of that. I think it's very difficult. I do think that taking Christianity out of schools was probably a mistake. I think it's probably a mistake, but I think it's also somewhat necessary too, because there were so many, like, okay, you have Christianity in schools, like, high level, that's great, okay, like, you learn to read the Bible and stuff, but then what happens when we have questions about free will or self-determinationism or, you know, whether or not, like, you know, like, there are a lot of differences between, even between the Protestant denominations, but then you add in Catholicism as well, and all of a sudden, like, things get really hairy when you're trying to teach Christianity in schools. And what undoubtedly is going to happen, and did happen when Christianity was still taught in public schools, is that you have situations where you have a very, let's just say, hypothetically, you know, a very Baptist community, okay? And there are a couple Catholic families that live in that community. They, you know, they drive, you know, an hour to go to Mass every Sunday. When what was happening was that those Catholic kids would go to school and they'd have to bring their Bible to learn, obviously. And they brought a, you know, Catholic 72-book Bible. And the Baptist teacher there is like, hey, you kids can't use that because that is not the Bible. That has 72 books. The Bible only has 65 books. And what was happening was that the kids were being sent home and told to get Protestant Bibles so they could learn in school. And obviously the Catholic parents didn't much care for that line of thinking. And so they started pulling their kids out of the public schools because they were indoctrinating Protestantism into the Catholic kids. And then that's actually the origin of Catholic schools in America, is that we needed a place for our children to go and learn about the Catholic, learn about Christianity through the, you know, through the Catholic lens. And as a result of that, then this is really what killed Christianity in schools. It wasn't like the secularization of the country like it is now. What really killed it was the fact that there were so many different differences between the denominations that it just didn't make sense for a public school to be teaching religion when there are so many different opinions. You know, and that's what killed it, unfortunately. You know, it's that there was really, honestly, it was the Protestant prejudices against Catholics that really killed it. Because all of a sudden you had, there was a very, it still is a very sizable Catholic population in the United States. And with the rate that Catholics were having babies back then too, especially, there were a lot of Catholic kids that were being pulled out of public schools, and it was creating a bit of a nightmare. And so the government was just kind of like, we can't do this anymore. Y'all can't play nice together, so you're all aren't going to play, you know, play it all in the schools. You know, like, we're not doing this. And so that made the public schools accessible to Catholics, which was a good thing, because not every parish had a school, but a bad thing in the sense that people weren't learning about religion in school anymore. Which, you know, high level, it should be good. You know, like, in general, like, you know, learning to read with Genesis and, you know, stuff would have been good. Learning that Jesus died for our sins would have been good. But, you know, the nature of children, though, is that they ask questions. And when you ask questions that aren't part of the, you know, the lesson plan, that's when you're going to go off the rails. And it's not right to expect a Baptist teacher to explain, you know, oh, the Catholics think this, and the Lutherans think this, and the Anglicans think this, and the Methodists think this, and the Baptists think this, and, you know, the, you know, all the way down the line. Like, it's too much to ask. So that's ultimately what killed Christianity in schools, unfortunately. But yeah, I do think America's going in the wrong direction. It's very hard to deny that. I just saw a weird U in my font. Where was that? I saw it and I took my eye off it, and then I can't find it now. Here we go. Nope. One. I don't think it was this high up. It's like right in this area someplace. It might have been this U. Not that one. Nope, we're good. That was so weird. Well, I thought I saw a weird letter in here. Anyways, yeah, I do think we're going in the wrong direction. I think we need to find some way to bring faith back into the public square. You know, like, we got this idea, and this is, I think this is secularism, where, like, there's this idea that it's like, it's not polite to talk about politics. It's not polite to talk about religion. Like, you just don't talk about those topics. And arguably, those are the two, religion being far more important than politics, but those are the two most important things we should be talking about in American culture, because we are supposed to be a government for the people, by the people, of the people. And if we don't talk about the government as the people, we lose the government. So it is important to talk about politics. But infinitely more important than that is to talk about religion, because these are the questions of our eternal salvation and eternal life. Like, you know, this life is a flash in the pan compared to what awaits us after our reward, you know? Yeah, it's a shame that that has become so embedded in how in just how we approach our social interactions on a daily basis. I mentioned the other day, like in a thing that, like, you know, if you talk about religion and work today, you get HR called on you. Like, you know, like that's how bad it's become. Like, it's really sad that we're at this point, you know. And I mean, it's gotten so bad now that even just saying that there is a objective truth, that there is one truth, you know, and that, you know, you don't have your truth and I don't have my truth, but there is a truth, and, you know, you and I can both be wrong. That alone is controversial today. And we see that now with, you know, transgenderism and everything else. Like, you know, to say like, oh, like you were made this way, you are a male/female, whatever, like, because that's how you were born and that's what your DNA is, that's offensive now. To say, like, to state scientific fact that this is your DNA is considered offensive now. And it's just like, we are heading down a very dangerous path. And thankfully, I don't think our culture and our society really embraced that. I think this was a step too far, maybe too quick, but I think it was a step too far. I think that after homosexual marriages were legalized in this country, I think after that happened, it emboldened a lot of people way too much. And I think that's why we are where we are right now. I don't think society in general is ready to give up on this. And so there's still some pushback, but, you know, at some point, like, the tide's going to turn against the conservative position. I shouldn't say conservative position, the traditional position again. And that's kind of the nature of time too. Like, over the course of time, things become more and more progressive. Things rarely become more traditional, you know? Tradition is slowly lost over time, and things just become more and more progressive until the new progressive becomes, you know, the old progressive becomes the new tradition, you know? I mean, it used to be that a conservative was somebody who, you know, didn't like the revolution and thought we should still be a part of Britain. So, like, you know, now conservative means somebody who embraced the ideas of the revolution. And increasingly, even from that, like, we're conservatives are kind of like moving away from the ideas of the revolution and supporting the ideas of the Ronald Reagan, or, you know, and even more recently than that, the ideas of, you know, just, you know, more recent political figures. And I don't know, it's just bad, you know. But the important, it is important to talk about those things, you know, to hopefully, like, stem the tide of the progressive movement. But at the same time, it's not worth it to be worried about it, because, again, I honestly believe that Christianity thrives the most when it's being challenged and when it's being oppressed. And so, like, I do think that we have some dark days ahead of us as Christians. But that's kind of a welcome challenge too. Like, you know, when Christians are being oppressed like that, that's where martyrs come from, you know? And those martyrs are the heroes of the faith. And, you know, we have a church that is built on the blood of martyrs. And, we always seem to forget that. You know, and then bad things happen, and then, you know, martyrs change the world, you know. So, you know, bring it on, I say, you know. And, you know, we get a little bit of a revival going maybe that way, but who knows. I heard the saying that we're not promised tomorrow, and that too is said. Yeah, we are not promised tomorrow. We're not promised the next moment. I've been praying on this more lately, but, like, you know, God sustains us. Like, our very being, moment to moment, is entirely just based on God's will to keep us in existence. Like, we are so dependent on God, we have no idea how dependent on God we are. And, like, I think a lot of people would be having existential crises if they fully understood just how dependent they were on, you know, God's will to keep them existing in this universe, you know? We have free will, but that free will operates in a realm that is entirely dependent on God keeping it present, you know? So, yeah, we are not promised tomorrow. At any moment, God can call us home to our reward. And, yeah, so this is, I always try to keep that in mind. Like, you never know when your number's coming up, you know? And, you know, like, you want to make sure you're living for the right reasons, and that is for His greater glory, you know, and not yours and not somebody else's, but especially not somebody else's, because that's not even self-serving at that point. You're like, you're just serving somebody else instead of God and instead of yourself, even. So that's the worst. Don't serve, like, you know, and when I say serve, I mean, like, serve is like serve, you would serve God, not like serve as you would serve yourself. But it's good to serve other people in the Christian sense. I'm not talking in the Christian sense with that, but yeah, like, you know, we're here to serve God, and, you know, we serve God through others. But hopefully that made sense what I said when I said it. But anyways, I just realized it is just about 1:30 in the morning here in the Chicagoland area, and with that, I think we're gonna call it. I spent way too much time drawing the olive tree thing up here and getting this set up and just ranting tonight. So, and then I had to run downstairs and get the Douay Rheims Bible to verify the weird grammar in there. But it's Douay Rheims for you, I guess. So, just came back, your battery died. Ah, you didn't miss much. Just me ranting about something random that I totally forgot about since then. So. Anyways, I am signing off because it is 1:30 in the morning. I wanted to get to bed at a reasonable time, and I utterly failed at that. But I will, let's see, I know I have a wedding to go to on Saturday, and I'm having dinner with my sister-in-law and wife on, tomorrow night. I don't know if that means I may or may not be streaming tomorrow night is what I'm trying to say. And then I probably will not be on Saturday. But I will try to get back in the habit of, or back in the process of doing it on Sunday at some point. But I will let you all know. If you want to follow my Discord, there should be a link someplace in the Twitch page, about section maybe someplace. If not, I think you can find it on ktracy.com. Feel free to join the Discord. I don't post on there very often, so it's not going to be blowing up your phone if you have notifications turned on. Don't worry about it. Try to keep an eye out for the stream, and have a very blessed night for you and all of your loved ones. Alrighty, that's it for me. Have a fantastic night, guys.